You're listening to the audio production of Philemon Audio Lectures by David E. Garland, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
In the 19th century, Jamie Lightfoot voices the opinion of many who delight in this brief letter to Philemon. He wrote, as an expression of simple dignity, of refined courtesy, of large sympathy, and of warm personal affection, the epistle to Philemon stands unrivaled. Donald Guthrie says that it breathes the great-hearted tenderness of the apostle. As heartwarming as Philemon is, it does have its frustrations for the interpreter. It leaves us in the dark about several things we would like to know to understand more fully the circumstances behind this letter. Reading Philemon is like coming into the middle of a movie and having to catch up on who the characters are and what has already happened in the plot, and then having to leave before the end. Paul does not tell us where he is in prison, what the conditions are like, or more to the point, how it happened that Onesimus came under his influence long enough for him to be converted. He also does not tell us why Onesimus fled his master, if indeed he did flee. Because of the letter's ambiguity on this point, some have argued that Onesimus had been sent to Paul by his master on some errand and only had overstayed his leave. Paul also does not state precisely what he wants Onesimus' master to do with him, except to regard him now as a brother in Christ. A student of ancient papyrus letters observes that he knows of no parallel in the ancient papyri that is as long as this one, or so oblique, so faltering, that one has difficulty in determining what it is precisely Paul requests. From the letter, we know only for sure that it was written during his confinement, and Paul had converted Onesimus. But there is no hint that Onesimus was a fellow prisoner. We also learn that Onesimus has been useful to Paul and served him in verses 11 and 13, and that before he had been useless to his master in verse 11, and he may have even done him wrong in some way according to verse 18. Paul sends him back with this letter in hopes that Philemon will do a good thing in verse 14, and will receive him graciously as a brother in Christ in verses 12, verse 17. But he also expresses the confidence that he will do even more than what Paul asks in verse 21. When we interpret the letter, we must fill in the gaps and make some assumptions about the situation. Two important questions need answers. What brought Onesimus to Paul? And what was Paul requesting Philemon to do when he sends Onesimus back? Well, the traditional view is that Onesimus was a runaway slave. As slaves were wont to do from time immemorial, Onesimus may have fled from his master, Philemon. Somehow, voluntarily or accidentally, he fell in with the Apostle Paul, who was able to win him to the faith. Scholars in this century have challenged this traditional scenario, and they call attention to the absence of any explicit mention in the letter that Onesimus had run away or of the need for his master to forgive his slave's flight. They also note that it would have been an astounding coincidence for a fugitive slave to meet Paul, the one person who knew his master during his imprisonment. For a slave to run away was a grave crime that the authorities in this era treated seriously. As a Roman citizen, Paul could have been given more freedom in his confinement. A captured runaway slave, however, would have been clapped in irons and kept under guard in a slave prison and not allowed free contact with Paul. How then could he have been of service to Paul, according to verse 13? If Onesimus were not a prisoner and had a freedom of movement, he could have done much for Paul. But how and why would he have had contact with the imprisoned Paul? We can only conjecture. Perhaps something other than happenstance brought Onesimus to Paul. But it may be that Onesimus was not a fugitive slave. It may be that he came to Paul in prison because his owner sent him there on behalf of the church in Colossae. But if Onesimus were not a Christian before he met Paul and was regarded as useless, according to verse 11, why would Philemon or the church entrust him with such a responsibility? Why let an undependable slave run loose across the countryside? Why charge a non-Christian with such an important spiritual mission? Was he the only one Philemon could spare? True, the owner might have sent Paul a worthless slave as a cost-effective but miserly way to help Paul. Or more positively, he was sent in the hope that contact with Paul might help straighten him out. But both options seem most improbable. What rules against this view is Paul's discreet mention of his willingness to reimburse the owner for any wrong that Onesimus may have done in verses 18 through 19. And his diplomatic description of Onesimus' separation from his master in verse 15, where he says, "He was separated from you for a little while." If the church had sent Onesimus, Paul could not have described him in the same glowing terms as he used for the Philippians' Epaphroditus, whom he says, "You sent to take care of my needs." It sounds as if Paul is gingerly searching in verses 15 through 16 for some euphemism to describe a getaway rather than a commissioning. He only mentions it to hint that there may have been some divine reason behind Onesimus' departure, that you might have him back for good, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. If Paul could find such a reason, it would help to absolve his guilt in keeping Onesimus so long. But Paul's hesitation in expressing his wish in verse 13, "I would like to have kept him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel," is also inexplicable if the church had sent Onesimus to serve him. If Paul wants to keep him longer, why does he need to send Onesimus back on a perilous journey home to obtain permission to keep his services, only to have him turn around and head back if Philemon grants him permission to return? Why not send Tychicus with a letter to make the request and keep his services a while longer while he waits for the reply? If Onesimus had been commissioned and sent to Paul by the church, why does Paul worry about how Onesimus might be received when he returns home, as he is concerned in verse 17? Paul does not seem anxious that his owner will allow Onesimus to continue to serve him, but that he may not embrace his slave as a brother in Christ. The case is based on an argument from silence that fails to consider rhetorical reasons why Paul does not explicitly mention Onesimus' wrongdoing. He employs extreme tact in this letter, which reveals that he is dealing with a very delicate situation in which Philemon could well react angrily. Yet Paul does allude to past problems. Onesimus has done something wrong to raise the ire of his master, and Paul seeks to intercede. The letter's ambiguity and our heightened sensitivity in this age to Paul's tacit endorsement of slavery, it prompted Alan Callahan to propose another radically different story behind the letter. His arguments raise a contemporary issue we must address. Why is it that Paul does not apply the gospel in the case before him to attack the inherent injustice of slavery? Paul not only does not condemn slavery for Christians, but he speaks glowingly of a member of the slaveholding class and treats Onesimus's flight as an injury to his master that requires restitution. Alan Callahan, an African-American scholar, notes how problematic this picture was for those African-Americans who endured the tyranny and humiliation of slavery, and how it remains a sensitive issue for their heirs today. He cites an example from the diary of Charles Colcock Jones, a white Presbyterian minister, who preached on Philemon to slaves in Georgia and was startled by their bitter reaction to his sermon. He writes in his diary, "When I insisted on fidelity and obedience as Christian virtues in servants, and upon the authority of Paul, condemned the practice of running away, one half of my audience deliberately rose up and walked off with themselves, and those who remained looked anything but satisfied, either with the preacher or his doctrine. After dismissal, there was no small stir among them. Some solemnly declared that there was no such epistle in the Bible. Others that they did not care if they ever heard me preach again." If you're familiar with the movie about Harriet Tubman, who frees slaves through the Underground Railroad, it's entitled simply Harriet. The opening scene begins with a reading from a passage in Colossians instructing slaves to obey. This scene is filled with irony. The masters listening in relish this reading that they believe reinforces the status quo and what they believe is their God-given authority over slaves. The slaves in the audience, however, hear it quite differently. They do not regard it as God's words to them, and the scene becomes quite ironic in the setting of the narrative of Harriet Tubman's history as an escaped slave and an abolitionist and social activists who conducted 13 missions to help other slaves escape. Alan Callahan solves this moral dilemma about Paul condoning slavery by arguing that Onesimus was not a slave, but Philemon's estranged younger brother, who ran to Paul to have him intercede in a family dispute. He points out that nowhere in the letter does Paul identify Philemon, or perhaps Archimus, as a master. He argues that Paul's plea to welcome Onesimus, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave as a dear brother in verse 16, does not refer to Onesimus's actual status as a slave. Instead, it refers to his virtual status in Philemon's eyes. Slave was an appropriate metaphor for one who is socially dead, who had no formal enforceable ties of blood. And Paul simply wants to effect domestic reconciliation, which explains the rich familial vocabulary in the letter. He contends, if Philemon is hospitable toward his brethren in the Lord, how much more incumbent upon him is it to be so toward one who is a member of his own family, as well as a member of the household of faith? He should be able to forgive the foibles of his brother in the flesh. And so Paul's plea in verse 16 is not that he accept Onesimus back as a brother, but as a beloved brother. This carefully argued thesis helpfully raises issues that we must address and shows how the issue of forgiveness lies at the heart of the letter, even though it's unstated. But nevertheless, I think it's a case of special pleading to avoid the unpleasant fact that Paul regarded running away as more wrong than slavery is. Paul does not specifically identify Philemon as Onesimus's.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.